Hello everyone. In this session, we'll be quickly revising the organs of abdomen and pelvis. Okay, we'll be revising in a way that it is useful for practical examinations. And at the end, I will also show you the 3D models of the abdomen and pelvis which I have. Okay, so let's begin. So what all topics I'll be covering in this particular session? I'll be covering all the major organs which are asked in practical or the viva examinations. So I'll be covering these organs: stomach, duodenum, pancreas, spleen, intestine, liver, kidney, posterior abdominal wall, urinary bladder, uterus along with the associated structures called as adnexa, and testis, and the mid-sagittal section of male pelvis as well as female pelvis. Okay. So before beginning with the individual organs, let's have a brief overview of the location of these organs. To understand the locations of these organs, the quadrants of the abdomen are important. So you all know how the 9 quadrants of the abdomen are divided. There are 2 vertical lines which are drawn at the level of the midpoint of the clavicle, that is the midclavicular line, and there are 2 horizontal lines. One is at the transpyloric plane, another is the intertubercular plane. Okay, this is at the level of L1 vertebrae and this is at the level of L5 vertebrae. Okay, so these 2 horizontal lines and these 2 vertical lines divide the abdominal quadrants into 9 regions. Okay, so here are the regions: epigastric, hypochondriac are the right and the left, umbilical, then right and the left lumbar, hypogastric, it is also referred to as suprapubic, and right and the left iliac. Okay, so where will be the stomach located? It is located in the epigastric region as well as some part of hypochondriac and the umbilical region. Okay, duodenum also located here in the epigastric region and some part in the umbilical region. Okay, pancreas, umbilical region, then as well as some part in the epigastric and the hypochondriac region. Okay, so location of these organs are very important because later on when a case presents with an abdominal pain, so one should know that which is the underlying organ in that particular region. Okay, so spleen is there in the left hypochondriac region, liver is there in the right hypochondriac region, as well as it extends into the epigastric and the left hypochondriac region. Okay, and uterus, urinary bladder, this is present in the pelvis. Okay, it's not directly palpable on the anterior abdominal wall, it's in the pelvic cavity. Okay, and testis is in the perineal region. Apart from these 9 regions, there is also a 10th region of the abdomen and pelvis that is referred to as the perineal region. Okay, so the genital organs are located there. Okay, so with this basic idea, let's begin with the discussion of the individual organs. Let's begin with the stomach first. So here we can see the specimen of the stomach, and for holding the stomach in anatomical position, it has to be held in left hand such that the palm goes on the posterior surface of the stomach. Okay, the 2 surfaces of the stomach, antero superior surface and postero inferior surface, then the ends of the stomach, this is the cardiac end of the stomach, this is the pyloric end of the stomach, then the other parts. Here we can see this is the lesser curvature of the stomach, this is the greater curvature of the stomach, and we have to divide the parts in the actual stomach. This is the fundus of the stomach, and there is a small part here called as the cardiac part of the stomach, and this is the body of the stomach, and this entire region is referred to as the pyloric part. Pyloric part has further subdivisions. There is the pyloric antrum, then pyloric canal, and there is a thick muscular fleshy part that is referred to as the pylorus. Okay, so these are the parts of the stomach, and you may be asked about the blood supply of the stomach. So how is the blood supply of the stomach? There is a celiac trunk, which is the artery of the foregut, so that gives a branch called as the left gastric artery. Then there is a tortuous branch, that is the splenic artery. Okay, it actually goes behind the stomach and then goes towards the spleen, which is on the left side, and there is one branch called as common hepatic artery, which gives a proper hepatic artery, and from there a branch comes that is the right gastric artery, okay, and there is one branch from here descending down that is the gastroduodenal artery, and from there also there is a branch called as right gastroepiploic artery, and from the splenic artery there is left gastroepiploic artery, okay. So all these are the blood vessels which supply the stomach, and we should also know about the various peritoneal relations of the stomach. There is the liver, right? From the liver there is a fold of peritoneum coming towards the stomach, that is the lesser omentum, and lesser omentum has got further parts. This is the hepatogastric ligament and hepatoduodenal ligament, okay, and along the greater curvature of the stomach majority of the part is by the greater omentum, and in the upper part some part goes towards the spleen, that is the gastrosplenic ligament, and some part goes towards the diaphragm, that is the gastrophrenic ligament, okay. So all these basic things we should be knowing with respect to the stomach, and also the lymphatic drainage of stomach is important. So to understand the lymphatic drainage, you can remember in relation with the arterial supply, like which arteries are present here. For example, here is the left gastric artery, so there is the left gastric lymph nodes, and right gastric artery, so here is the right gastric lymph nodes, then here is the pancreaticosplenic lymph nodes, then right gastroepiploic lymph nodes according to the location of the blood vessels, and near the pylorus there is pyloric lymph nodes. From all these regions the lymphatics ultimately go into a group of lymph nodes called as celiac group of lymph nodes, okay. Lymphatic drainage is very important because the cancers of the stomach, like they are transmitted to different organs through the lymphatic drainage, okay. And this image shows the interior of the stomach. So what all things in the interior we can appreciate, there are certain folds here, these folds are referred to as rugae, okay. Then there will be minute pits, which are the openings of the gastric glands, okay. So gastric rugae, gastric pits, and along the lesser curvature we can see a canal here, okay. This canal is called as the gastric canal, is also called as canal of Magenstrasse, okay. So three key features in the interior of the stomach are gastric rugae, gastric pits, and gastric canal of Magenstrasse, okay. And in the lesser curvature we can see an abrupt curvature here, okay. The lesser curvature is bending here. This angle is referred to as incisura angularis, okay. In applied anatomy of stomach we can remember gastric ulcers, then gastric carcinoma is more common along the greater curvature, ulcers are more common along the lesser curvature, okay. And for gastric ulcers there is a surgical procedure this called as vagotomy. It is obsolete nowadays, but still as per theory we should know that there are different types of vagotomies which are performed for the gastric ulcer, okay. Nowadays like with medicines itself gastric ulcers are treated. Now let's move on to the next organ. So in this specimen we can see the duodenum, pancreas, as well as spleen, okay. So duodenum, as we can see, it is a C-shaped organ. So it has got parts. Here is the first part of the duodenum, then this vertical part is the second part, and this horizontal part is the third part, and there is some part extending beyond this also, that is the fourth part of the duodenum, okay. So four parts of the duodenum we should know, and in the C-shaped curvature of the duodenum the head of the pancreas is located, okay. Head of the pancreas, and there is a small projection from the head, that is the uncinate process of the pancreas, and this is the body of the pancreas, and this is the tail of the pancreas, okay. Tail of the pancreas is related with the spleen, okay. This region of the spleen is referred to as the hilum of the spleen, okay. So the tail of the pancreas is related with the hilum of the spleen, okay. So basically we should be able to identify this specimen usually when the specimen of pancreas is kept, it is kept along with the duodenum. Okay, that's how easily you can remember. Spleen may not be there, but usually duodenum is present along with the pancreas. Okay, and little details about it: the arterial supply, the superior pancreaticoduodenal artery, inferior pancreaticoduodenal artery. Then for the pancreas, the major branch is arteria pancreatica magna. It is a branch from the splenic artery. Okay, and splenic artery, as we know, it is a direct branch from the celiac trunk. So this was about duodenum, pancreas. Spleen, we have a different specimen as well. In that, I'll discuss the various relations of the spleen. Before that, let's just look at the interior of the duodenum. Interior of the duodenum will show one characteristic opening, that is the major duodenal papilla. Okay? There is a main pancreatic duct as well as accessory pancreatic duct. The main pancreatic duct opens into the major duodenal papilla. Okay? And the mucosal folds, which are present in the interior of the duodenum. Then there's a fold above this major duodenal papilla that is called as plica semicircularis. And there's a fold called as plica longitudinalis, a longitudinal fold just below this major duodenal papilla. Okay? So these are certain key features you can remember for the interior of the duodenum. And this is a specimen of spleen. We are looking at the visceral surface of the spleen. And while describing the spleen, there is something called as Harris dictum, which we should know. It's a dictum of odd numbers 1, 3, 5, 7, and 9, and 11. Okay, these odd numbers we need to remember for description of the spleen. Spleen is 1 inches thick, it is 3 inches in breadth, it's 5 inches in length, is 7 ounces in weight. 7 ounces is approximately 200 grams, and it lies between 9th and the 11th ribs. Okay, so this is called as the Harris dictum of odd numbers for the description of the spleen. Okay, and for the external features, it has got an anterior end, a posterior end, and surfaces are the diaphragmatic surface, visceral surface, and borders. You can see this is a superior border. And superior border continues as the intermediate border, and here is the inferior border. Okay, so there are three borders, two surfaces, and two ends. And we should note the relations of this visceral surface. Diaphragmatic surface, as the name suggests, it is related with the diaphragm as well as the ribs and the intercostal spaces. And visceral surface, which all organs are related, the largest impression is of the stomach. Okay. So stomach is related here, then this region is related with the left kidney. Okay, stomach, left kidney, and this region is related with the flexure of the colon, the splenic flexure of the colon. Okay, and this region is the hilum of the spleen. It is related with the tail of the pancreas. Okay, and the various peritoneal relations of the spleen we should know. There is a ligament from the stomach to the spleen that is called as the gastrosplenic ligament, and from the spleen is called as linorenal ligament. And there is one ligament which is a fold of peritoneum which supports the spleen from the anterior aspect, that is the phrenicocolic ligament. Okay, and we should know the contents of these ligaments as well. Gastrosplenic ligaments contain splenic artery as well as the tail of the pancreas. Okay, and linorenal ligament, it contains the short gastric arteries. Okay, the relation of the tail of the pancreas with the hilum is very important, surgically very important, because whenever splenectomy is performed, careful resection has to be done in this region so that the tail of the pancreas is preserved. Okay, because the tail of the pancreas consists of excess number of islets of Langerhans. Okay, so if it gets damaged, it may lead to iatrogenic diabetes mellitus. Okay, and spleen is also one of the most common organ for rupture in blue to the abdominal organs. Spleen is the most common organ to get ruptured, and the blood oozes out, and it may irritate the left-sided diaphragm. Okay, that is referred to as Kerr sign, KEHR, Kerr sign, because it is actually pain radiating towards the left shoulder because the left-sided diaphragm is irritated, which is supplied by the same spinal segments C3, C4. Okay. Now let's start with the small intestine. Here we can see the specimen of small intestine. So whenever a specimen of small intestine is kept, it is only the jejunum and ileum together. Okay. Duodenum is usually a separate specimen, and jejunum and ileum together are one specimen. Okay. And whenever this specimen is given, you'll be asked to differentiate jejunum from ileum, or else you may be asked to differentiate small intestine from the large intestine. Okay. So basic differentiating points we should know. First, let's see the differences between jejunum and ileum. So to understand the differences, we will have to lift the specimen of the small intestine and view it in the region where there is light source. Okay. So we will see this kind of image. So here we can see this vertical running blood vessels. These are referred to as vasa recti. Vasa recti, okay, straight blood vessels, and these are referred to as arcades. So in jejunum, arcades are less, vasa recti are long. Okay. And in ileum, this arcades will be more in number and there will be short vasa recti. Okay. So this is one of the most important difference to differentiate jejunum from ileum. There might be other differences as well, like the thickness of the wall, then the lumen, but with that it becomes difficult to differentiate. This is the most important thing that you need to look for, the arcades and the vasa recti. Okay. And also this region between the vasa recti, we can see transparent area that is referred to as the peritoneal window, that is seen more clearly in jejunum because of less fat content here, whereas in ileum fat content is more. Okay, let's look at the specimen of ileum as well. So here we can see the specimen of ileum. Just compare this more number of arcades and short vasa recti. Okay, so here we can see arcade, arcade, arcade. Okay, this region is the vasa recti, which is short, and also the fat content is more here in this mesentery. Okay. Lumen of this ileum, it is smaller as compared to that of the jejunum. But as I said, other differences, it is difficult to differentiate. Easily you can differentiate by looking at the arcades and the vasa recti. Okay, more arcades and short vasa recti means it is ileum, and less arcades and long vasa recti means it is jejunum. Okay. And this image shows the difference between the interior of jejunum and interior of ileum. Here we can see the mucosal folds here. These are referred to as walls of Kerkering. These are also referred to as plicae circularis. And in radiology, these folds are referred to as valvulae conimentis. Okay. So this jejunum, we can see multiple small folds which are placed close to each other. Whereas in ileum, they are placed wide apart, and also it has got an aggregated lymphoid follicle, that is a Peyer's patch. Okay, that may be seen in the ileum. So there is one difference that we should know in the interior of jejunum and ileum. Okay. Then how to differentiate the entire small intestine from the large intestine? So when a specimen is kept, so here we can see it has got a huge mesentery along with the intestine, whereas in large intestine you may not be able to look at a huge mesentery because the ascending colon is retroperitoneal, the descending colon is retroperitoneal, only mesentery is present in the transverse colon. Okay, so that also most of the times gets cut off when the specimen is removed. So the specimen of large intestine looks like this. It will be present along with the cecum, appendix, an ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, that will continue as the sigmoid colon, that will further continue as the rectum, okay? And usually the part of the rectum is not there in the specimen. Rectum is most of the times left in the posterior abdominal wall itself, okay? And what is the major difference, major differences between small intestine and large intestine? So there are some cardinal features of large intestine which will help you to differentiate with small intestine. One is tenia coli. These are longitudinal bands of muscles. Okay, those are referred to as tenia coli. There are three bands which are present. Then there is outpouching of this peritoneum that is referred to as the appendices epiploicae. Okay, so appendices epiploicae. Then tenia coli, and there is third feature that is referred to as sacculations or haustrations. Okay, those are foldings of this wall of the large intestine. Okay, those are referred to as sacculations. So these are the cardinal features of large intestine that helps us to differentiate between large intestine and small intestine. Okay, and if we see in microanatomy, the small intestine has got villi which is absent in large intestine. That is one of the important key microanatomical difference between small intestine and large intestine. Okay, so here is a separate specimen of cecum and appendix. This we can see, this is the cecum and here this is the appendix. Okay, this is the terminal part of the ileum which is opening into the cecum in the ileocecal junction. Okay, and in appendix we should be aware of various positions of the appendix, and one of the most common position is retrocecal. We also refer to as the 12 o'clock position of the appendix, where the appendix is behind the cecum and it is more towards the upper aspect. That's referred to as the retrocecal appendix. Okay, then arterial supply to the appendix is by the appendicular artery. It is a branch from the ileocolic artery. And ileocolic artery itself is branched from the superior mesenteric artery. Okay, then cecum, and in appendix there is a common clinical condition called as appendicitis, the pain of which radiates onto the anterior abdominal wall. The site on which there is maximum pain, that is referred to as the McBurney's point. It is at the junction of the medial two-thirds and the lateral one-third of the line joining the anterior superior iliac spine to the umbilicus. So for PDF handout, you all can WhatsApp me at this number, and please do watch the other sessions of this YouTube channel.